that one's wonderful PTA Deputy Secretary of Rural Pangapua. Thank you so much. Now next, to give us a few words, please help me welcome the Deputy Chief of Mission of the Embassy of Japan, Mr. Yamamoto Yasuji, along warm applause.
Ministers of the Bantamaw Transition Authority, members of Bantamaw Island, international and local partners, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is our honor to hold Bantamaw Forum co-hosted by the Embassy of Japan and the United Nations. Today we are focusing on three topics. Globalization, intergovernmental relations body, and PTA. All of us is to know the overall picture and to have an idea of how they are linked together to achieve. It is second time for us to co-host this kind of event together. Last event was more than 1 year ago. In December 2018, it was called the Bantamaw Forum, held in Manila. At that time, the event was focusing on the international community to have common understanding to preside transition to Bantamaw Transition Authority and the normalization. All the processes in the year 2019 and what has been happening is what were shared at that forum. There was a plebiscite. There was an outtaking of PTA members in Tanzania on February 22nd. And there was an inauguration ceremony of PTA at this hall on March. Approval of the budget in November was another big step forward. I would like to explain. Another important process is decommissioning, which started from end of August 2019. Japan is supporting the normalization process by construction of JPSD stations and providing vehicles to increase transport capacity of related mechanisms. The government of Japan, which has worked tirelessly to push for the Mindanao peace process, through Japan Bantamaw initiatives for reconstruction and development of development, or JBA program, Japan has contributed over 25 billion pesos since 2002 in Mindanao's conflict affected areas to enable its people to experience the dividends of peace. Since 2006, Japan has deployed socio-economic development experts to the International Monitoring Team, or IMT. We also have JICA projects. JICA project office in Cotabasco of lending a hand to the Mindanao peace process, for we share with the Philippine government the dream of an enduring peace and a better life for the Bantamaw. In time, this will bring about greater stability and prosperity in the Southeast Asia region as a whole.
Bantamaw, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamualaikum, magandang araw po. I'd like to thank the Embassy of Japan and the
Chinese and Chinese
Relay Coordinator for inviting me to deliver a few words on behalf of the entire United Nations assistant in the Philippines to you all At this moment, that's the event of the second Bantamoro Presence Forum. As Ms. Ayamonte just said, since the first forum, a lot has happened. I still remember the sense of deep privilege and excitement that I felt when I was invited and witnessed at IOG there when my friend from the UNICEF said, almost a year ago, this historic inauguration of the BAM BTA in this very SACC on the 29th of the March 2019, following the overwhelming popular vote for supporting the Bantamoro organic law by the predecessors. As the previous eminent speakers already said, me too, I look forward to today's forum as an opportunity to listen to the progress made in the last 1 year, and also updates and discussions on the first Bantamoro development plan, and for us all to leave this room with a common understanding about the needs and areas for continued and coordinated support to collectively make sure that this commission is a success leading towards elections in 2022. Standing here in front of you humbles me because you are the ones who made this history happen. This hall, where all of us are assembled today, is now the legislative heart of the BAM. The parliamentary system that BOL has introduced is a manifestation of the desire of the Bantamoro people calling for a different, more accountable form of governance that better governs, serves the people. The BOL has also enabled a new budgeting process to access the block grant allocation. As mentioned, we also witnessed a high-level intergovernmental relations body established as a key institutional arrangement to ensure the effective vertical coordination between the BAM and Manila. Another achievement, which was also mentioned, is the successful decommissioning of more than 9,000 MIF combatants and continuing as a key component of the normalization process. Time lies indeed, and we have 3 years left till the tenure of the BTA. As in the cases of all the other peace processes and agreements and democratic systems in the world, it will continue to be a challenge to manage expectations while setting up governance and accountability mechanisms, capacitating bureaucrats and public servants, ensuring sustainable revenues and quality social services, and also making sure that inclusion and meaningful participation of youth and women, children, and civil society in these processes. Ladies and gentlemen, this year 2020 is the 75th anniversary of the creation of the United Nations. And as you know, the Philippines is one of the 51 founding members of the United Nations. With the United Nations agencies have been present in this country for almost that long, many years in the BAM areas as well. Last time I checked, there are, as we speak, a total of as many as 200 UN personnel permanently based and working here in the BAM, representing 14 different UN agencies, implementing 87 various projects in BAM, with a total budget of $178 million. Most of the funding comes from the international partners, United Kingdom, just to name a few, who contribute these additional voluntary funding, in addition to the member states' core contribution at the headquarters level, and to all those UN member states, including the Philippines, many present here today, I'd like to express our deep gratitude on behalf of the United Nations. I'd like to hereby reiterate the commitment of the UN system in the Philippines, that we shall continue to stand ready to provide all that we can in our capacity, if so requested by you, of course, whether it's for emergency response, long-term development efforts, or for the peace building, because we have expertise in many different sectors and issues. Leaving no one behind is one of the core principles of the partnership between the Philippines and the United Nations, in line with Agenda 2030 for sustainable development. In the context of Bansan Law, the United Nations will strive to support the environment of all communities, the morals, the non-moral indigenous people, minority religious groups, and IDPs, toward a more inclusive and equitable growth with decent work for all, sustainable socio-economic development with quality social and protection services, including for women and children, and for traditional justice, reconciliation, and global peace. Again, congratulations to all of you on many landmark achievements made thus far, and wish you all very fruitful deliberations today. Shukran, Maraming Salamat.
Thank you so much to all our speakers for welcoming our guests for today. But before we proceed with the first part of the forum, may we ask our four speakers to stand for a quick oath of office. Again, Assistant Secretary of the Mayor, Chief of Staff, OPA, Mr. Abdul Rahul Pabakwa, PTA Executive Secretary, Mr. Yamamoto Yasushi, Deputy Chief of Mission Embassy of Japan, and Mr. Yori Matthew, UNRC, and representative of the UNFPA Philippines. Thank you so much. Here in the middle, facing there so that the audience can be captured. Okay, thank you once again. And to our four speakers, you may proceed to the front seat so that you occupy seats allotted for you. Formalization. And to lead the discussion, may I call on stage our speakers. Music David B. Dichano, the Chair of GBH Implementing Panel, and MILF East Implementing Panel Chairman, Mr. Mohajer Iqbal. And once again, we invite Mr. David Dichana, the GPA Implementing Panel Chairman, to give his presentation. David Dichana.
Distinguished members of the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, officials of the Bangsamoro government, representatives of the diplomatic community, and our international partners in development in the Bangsamoro, other special guests, members of the media, good morning. Please allow me to present the updates on the peace process between the government of the Philippines and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, particularly in the process in the implementation of the program for normalization in Bangsamoro. To recall, normalization was defined in our signed agreements as a process whereby communities can achieve their desired quality of life, which includes the pursuit of sustainable livelihood and political participation within a peaceful, deliberative society. The normalization process is implemented alongside the progress in the political track of the implementation of the comprehensive agreement of the Bangsamoro. As shown, the normalization track keeps up with the progress in the political track, especially now that the Bangsamoro Transition Authority is already being operationalized. The Executive Order Number 79, prompting the creation of the Inter-Cabinet Cluster Mechanism on Normalization. The ICCMN is co-chaired by Cabinet Secretary Carlo Morales and Presidential Advisor on Peace, Reconciliation and Unity, Secretary Carlito Gabriel Jr. It has the following members, member agencies from the national government assured, divided into four clusters based on the four aspects of normalization, namely, security, socio-economic development programs, confidence-building measures, and transitional justice and reconciliation. The ICCMN has already conducted four meetings with its clusters conducting their own meetings to press out details on the implementation of its aspect of normalization. Shown here are the mechanisms that implement the different aspects of the normalization process. It will be discussed one by one. The committee, the Joint Peace and Security Committee, and the Joint Peace and Security Days. The JNC undertakes the primary functions of coordinating the normalization process. The JNC coordinates with command structures of the GPAs and MIRF on security arrangements and develops policies and operational guidelines for effective partnership of the GPAs. The JPSC also coordinates security arrangements for activities related to the implementation of the GAP. The JPSC also are operating units composed of contingents of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, the Philippine National Police, and the Bangsamoro Islamic Armed Forces of the MIRF, the BIAC MIRF. The JPSC shall work for the maintenance of peace and order and stability areas fully identified by the GPAs and the MIRF. There will be 300 JPSC teams composed of 30 member seats, 15 from the GPH, with contingents from the AFP and the PNP, and 15 from the BF MILF. From November to December 2018, there were 153 members of the AFP, PNP, and BF MILF who underwent JPS training at the PPS Training Center, PNP, at the ProArm para Manila. On August 26 of last year, 219 BF MILF members finished their 26-day basic military training at Camp Lucero Men, North Cotabato, as a requirement to their participation in the JPSs. From October 21 to November 22, 2019, 317 JPSC members underwent the second batch of the JPSC training. Here are the deployment areas of JPSCs, which are newly identified by the JPSCs and the MILF. Six of which JPSCs are currently deployed as follows. One in Camp Abu Bakar, one in the Operation Center at the DPWH building compound in Cotabato, Awan. Four teams are deployed with the Independent Decommissioning Body headquarters. On decommissioning, the Independent Decommissioning Body established in 2014 is mandated by the DPH and the MILF to oversee the process of decommissioning of MILF forces and weapons. The IDB also monitors the secured arms storage area where decommissioned weapons are stored. The MILF shall undertake a graduated program for decommissioning of its forces so that they are put beyond use. Decommissioning includes activities aimed at achieving a smooth transition of PIAF MILF members to productive civilian life. Based on the annex on normalization, the decommissioning of MILF forces and weapons shall be in parallel and commensurate with the implementation of all agreements of the DPH and the MILF. The decommissioning of MILF forces and weapons is done in four phases. On June 16, 2015, the ceremonial decommissioning of 145 combatants and 75 high-power firearms and crucial weapons of the MILF were conducted. The second phase of decommissioning is currently ongoing, where 30% of MILF combatants and weapons will be decommissioned. This shall be followed by the third phase of decommissioning, which will be held later this year. In 2021 to 2022, the final phase of decommissioning of MILF combatants and weapons will be conducted prior to the signing of the exit agreement between the DPH and the MILF. The second phase of the decommissioning process began on August 26, 2019, and on September 2, 2019, it was formally launched at the old Maguindanao Provincial Capital, Sultan Kadarat, Maguindanao. This was attended by Lorenzen, our President, Rodrigo Lawal Perry. As of December 4 last year, there were 8,879 combatants and 1,542 firearms were decommissioned for the second phase and will resume today, February 18, 2020, to process more than 3,000 combatants and 300 plus more firearms. On policing, Section 2, Article 11 of the Republic Act number 11054 or the Balsamoro Organic Law provides that the PNP shall create a police region office in Bern, headed by the regional director. On September 24, 2019, the National Police Commission, NAPACO, issued resolution number 2019-634, approving the reorganization and renaming of the PNP Pro Arm to PNP Pro Bar. Another dimension under the security aspect is the redeployment of the AFP. Based on mechanics for normalization, the AFP shall redeploy units and troops from or within the Bangsamoro, consistent with a normal and peaceful life and progress in the other aspect of normalization. A joint security assessment and inventory of AFP units and troops shall be conducted to avoid necessary for national defense and security. On September 3, 2015, the Office of the President issued Memorandum Circular Number 83, creating the National Task Force for the disbandment of private armed groups in the areas of the proposed Bangsamoro and the adjacent regions of Region 9 and Region 12. The NTFD PACs will be in charge of the policy, planning and implementation of the program for the disbandment of private armed groups under the security aspect of normalization. Its implementation rules and operational guidelines is currently with the Office of the Executive Secretary for approval. On the second aspect of urbanization is the socio-economic development, which is primarily overseen by the Task Force for the Commission Combatants and their Communities. The TFDCC is mandated to identify, undertake efforts, coordinate government and non-government partners, and address implementation concerns related to socio-economic and development programs for MIR combatants and their communities. The TFDCC is composed of representatives of the Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, the Department of Social Welfare and Development, and the Department of Interior and Local Government, and on the DPA side, and the MIR on the other side. The delivery of initial socio-economic packages to the 145 division combatants from the first phase of the commissioning have already been completed. The TFDCC is currently rolling out the enhanced program of interventions and implementation mechanisms for the commission combatants under the first and second phase. The enhanced program of interventions for the division combatants include social protection, livelihood or employment assistance, capacity development, and physical infrastructure or land title. Upon decommissioning, its decommission combatants shall receive immediate cash assistance worth 100 pesos and undergo PSWB social welfare intake or profiling. As part of the confidence building measures between the DPAs and the MILF, and as a gesture of goodwill, the parties created the Joint Task Forces on Transformation to assess the needs, plan operating programs, and undertake the necessary measures to transform the six MILF camps after its 1999 into a peaceful and productive communities. The Joint Task Force for each of the six camps is composed of two members, each from the DPAs and the MILF, and it's co-chaired each from the DPAs and MILF head to the Joint Task Force on Camp Transformation. John R. D. Yancis, previously acknowledged MIF camps deployed as follows. In Camp Pilar, Mindanao provinces, Camp Pusa, Mindanao del Sur, Camp Apobacar in Maguindanao, Camp Padre in Maguindanao, Camp Tajamuda in North Cotabato in Maguindanao, Camp Oman in Maguindanao. These are some of the strategies to transform the 6 MILF camps: social infrastructure, economic infrastructure, and access to economic opportunities. In 2017, the Joint Task Force on Camp Transformation turned over 3,001 solar kits to individual households and communal facilities in the 6 camps as part of the quick response projects. Capacity development trainings for the JTFCTs and camps-based people's organizations were conducted in 2018. These include trainings on project management and participatory area development. The social preparation process for the implementation of camps transformation program and quick response projects are currently ongoing. 14 people's organizations were organized across the 6 camps to serve as partners in operation and maintenance. The JTFCTs conducted an exposure program and capacity development for MILF front and base commanders on agricultural production from June 24 to July 4, 2019. And on next week, from February 24 to 29, 2020, a similar activity will be conducted to focus on good governance. The JTFCT is also independent of the camp's transformation plan. Starting today until February 20, they will conduct a formulation workshop on the camp's transformation plan. To facilitate the healing of the wounds of conflict and the return to normal life, the DPAs shall take immediate steps through amnesty, pardon, and other available processes towards the resolution of cases of persons charged with or convicted of crimes and offenses connected to the armed conflict in Mindanao. So the Department of Justice, DOJ, and OPAC are currently conducting initial coordination and evaluation of the issuance of safe conduct passes, amnesty and pardon for MIF members charged and convicted of crimes and offenses. At present, safe conduct passes have been issued to the 6 MIF leaders and other base commanders. Currently, the OPAC is processing 16 MIF front and base commanders with various cases. In 2014, the bargains created the Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission, or the TJRC. The TJRC is chaired by a Swiss expert with one representative, each from the DPAs and the MIF as members. The TJRC is mandated to undertake a study and recommend to the panels the appropriate mechanisms to address the grievances of the Bangsamoro people, correct historical injustices, and address human rights violations. In its main report, the TJRC recommended the creation of the National Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission for the Bangsamoro NTJRC, as well as some actions, mostly for government agencies. The TJRC officially turned over its main report to the DPAs and MILF panels on February 11, 2016, for their father election. And regarding the incident, it's a period, it's supplementary efforts, namely listening class support, that report dealing with the past and that association, the technical report with the World Bank and International Organization for Migration entitled that territory domain and identity. Two major capacity building interventions were also conducted to implement the ICCMN Transitional Justice and Conciliation Council as follows. Training camp on TJR organized and provided by the Independent Working Group on the TJDWP for key members of the ICCMN TJR on 18 to 20 November 2019 in the Newport City. We also have the capacity building for the AAP's Technical Working Group on TJR that was conducted on 27 to 29 November 2019 in Tagaytay City. These capacity building interventions resulted to an increased understanding and appreciation of the AAP response to the Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission recommendations. It also provided an avenue for the mapping of agency programs. And most importantly, these trainings equipped them with the necessary knowledge and skills for the formulation of the TJR roadmap of the 90 plus recommendations. The iterative TJR roadmapping process also served as a strategy to solidify government's position and strengthen its commitment in responding to the TJRC report and its recommendations along the four BWP's pillars, namely right to know, right to justice, right to reparation, and guarantee of non-violence. On the roadmap formulation, compliance approval is being sought from the ICCMN and eventually with the government implementing panel, and once approved, it will be presented to the MIM implementing panel for its review and eventually its compliance. The joint approval of the panel's TJR roadmap is critical and shall serve as a guide for the implementation of the TJR program. This is the final slide of the court. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much, Mr. David Cristiano. Now let us hear from the MILFP's implementing panel chairman, Minister Bogier Iqbal. Round of applause, please.
Brother,
Assistant Secretary Walden Umayo. Brother Alan Sali. Our friend from the West Coast Brother, Minister Ali Sulaiman. My former partner in government, as chair of the government of this panel, Attorney Rajiv Lal, police in the DPA, police in the MILN, other ministers who are with us this morning, our friends from the media, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First and foremost, I want to give my heartfelt gratitude to the United Nations. The Japan embassy and JICA for their continued support for the development of this process, and the fulfillment of the Chief Minister's worldwide private agenda for the development of the Mosaic Industry in the law. I also want to express thanks for the organization of this forum, wherein we had the opportunity to discuss updates on the peace process, which is critical for both members of the Guantanamo Transition Authority, for the government, the environment, and of course, for the international community. It is so inspiring for all that a year has already passed since we established the Guantanamo Transition Authority, shortly after the ratification of the Guantanamo Organic Law for Republic Act 110.4, and the bar. The creation of the bar and the appointment of environment leaders in critical positions in the interim government are a direct result of this process between the government of the Philippines and the Board of Islamic Liberation Front. The outcome of this process is now in the transition and implementation phase. Ergo, both parties have to simplify a high level of trust and confidence in each other, perseverance, resourcefulness, and earnestness to fulfill all obligations stated in the Guantanamo Organic Law and the scientific agreements, namely the 2012 framework agreement on the Guantanamo and its four annexes and the 2014 framework agreement on the Guantanamo. I was requested by the organizers to speak on the normalization projects, the cornerstone for the peace implementation phase. According to the framework agreement of the Guantanamo, normalization is a process whereby communities can achieve a desired quality of life, which includes the pursuit of sustainable livelihood and political participation within a peaceful democratic society. Furthermore, normalization aims to ensure human security in the Guantanamo, help build a society that is committed to basic human rights, where individuals are free from fear or violence or crime, and where long-held traditions and values continue to be followed. In other words, normalization aims to contribute to the creation of a stable, peaceful, just, and prosperous Guantanamo. In this regard, normalization is composed of 8 substantive elements designed to instigate political, economic, security, and social structural changes needed to eliminate past grievances and provide for a more fair and equitable future for the combatants of the Guantanamo. The elements are as follows.
पुलिसिंग निर्माण चक्र नंबर को प्रवेश और दर्शन शिक्षण को पाने सबका परिचयशन नेहरू जॉइंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को निधि जॉइंट पीस एंड सिक्योरिटी को निधि एंड जॉइंट पीस एंड सिक्योरिटी टीम्स नंबर थ्री कॉन्फिडेंस बिल्डिंग मेजर सच एज पार्टनर एंड आर्मी एज वेल एज स्पेशलाइज्ड प्रोग्राम फॉर द सिक्स एक्नॉलेज्ड फंड्स ऑन द एनवायरनमेंट Number four, socio-economic development program. Number five, the commissioning of acquired frequency and commerce and urban diagnosis. Number six, traditional justice and reconciliation program. Number seven, disbandment of private armed groups. And number eight, reintegration of armed forces of the Philippines in the Manila Bay. Upon cross inspection, you will realize that these elements supplement one another. For instance, it would be difficult for any socio-economic intervention to thrive if the security situation on the ground is not improved. In this regard, the role of the International Monitoring Team, or IMT, which, alongside other ceasefire mechanisms, is very much imperative for in this interval after the signing of the agreement. Moreover, confidence in the decommissioning process will falter if illegal private armed groups are still prevalent. In other words, all components must be simultaneously implemented. My chief partner from the CPSG's implementing partner, Under Secretary Luciano, presented a significant update on the decommissioning and the security aspect of the organization. I now have the privilege to lead the discussion on the socio-economic component, confidence building measures for CBN, transitional justice and reconciliation, and normalization trust fund for the NPF. But you will realize in the course of my presentation that part of those presentations are already passed by my good counterpart or partner in government, and this is good because it supplements each other. Together with the updates on the normalization topics, I believe it is worthwhile to find essential provisions in the peace agreements and the Bangsamoro Organic Law. Moreover, we must revisit the fundamental principles that have guided this process. We should remain consistent with our goal as per the ideals, needs, and aspirations of the Bangsamoro people. At this juncture, I shall now proceed to the core of my presentation this morning. Socio-economic component. As per the framework agreement on Bangsamoro and later normalization, the parties agreed to intensify development efforts for rehabilitation, reconstruction, and development of the Bangsamoro, and institute programs to address the needs of PF members, internally displaced persons, and poverty-stricken communities. Therefore, the socio-economic component of the normalization process is paramount. This intervention shall also instigate the devastating effects of the decades old armed conflict. More importantly, I would support the economic packages, particularly the housing portion. The timing and phasing of socio-economic interventions are crucial. Delays in providing basic needs could lead to aggravation among the decommissioned combatants, which we hope to prevent. I also mentioned that under Article 14 of the Bangsamoro Organic Law, the national government will also provide a special development fund for the rebuilding, rehabilitation, and development of its conflicted affected communities. The special development fund amounts to 50 billion that will be allocated 5 billion per year in the next 10 years after the ratification of the Bangsamoro Organic Law. Program under the SDF and complement development projects under the normalization process. Finally, I
as part of our monitoring and evaluation efforts, there are plans coming up and assessment on the current situation of the 145 MIA commanders who underwent the ceremonial recognition process in 2015. The result of this evaluation would help improve the next round of decommissioning, especially the delivery and use of socio-economic packages. On conflict dealing measures, my group, the partners, are able to discuss this, but nevertheless, I will still continue to get my presentation. Interrelated to the socio-economic component is the confidence building measures, or CBM. Under the annex on normalization, confidence building measures refers to two kinds of interventions. One, the transformation of the six MILF previously acknowledged MILF plans into product and communities and other applicable processes to resolve the cases of persons judged or connected or committed in crimes related to armed conflict. Under the transformation, the GPS and the MILF is implementing plans created the Joint Task Force for Plan Transformation by signing its term of reference on February 11, 2016 in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. The responsibilities of the Joint Task Force are to assess the needs, plan the appropriate programs, and undertake necessary measures to transform the following six acknowledged MILF plans, Lampa Mubakar, City, Tangira, Ilano Dinoti, Tampuara, in Maguindanao, Tampu Yamuna, in Norte Tabato, Tampador, in Maguindanao, Tampu Sra, in Lano Bisu. The Joint Task Force, composed of representatives from the CTS and MILF, has made strides last year. Allow me to highlight some of the milestones discussed in the 2019 accomplishment report. One, the conduct of the exposure program and initial camp studies, where 79 representatives from the MILF units and committees, such as peace mechanism, political committees, base and front commanders, but Samora Islamic auxiliary, but Samora Islamic women auxiliary, and the social welfare committee were votes on agricultural technology and farming innovation. Number two, the GPFCT extended a partnership with the Bang Samora Planning and Development Authority for BGDA Farm to formulate a plant transformation plan. A series of roundtable discussions and consultations were conducted between September to December 2019 to support this planning process. These were attended by representatives from the BETA, Mineral Development Authority, National Economic Development Authority, and MILF Front and Base Commanders across six MILF plans. Number three, through the efforts of the Joint Task Force on Plant Transformation and the Task Force for the Commission Competence and their communities, 4,859 beneficiaries from Tampu Mubakar, Badar, Umar, Kajamuna, and Arapanan availed the tulong ang hanap buhay sa ating disadvantaged displaced workers or KUPAS through Dole Region Block. This program provided emergency employment for the displaced workers for a period of 30 working days starting November 26, 2019 to December 30, 2019. To support camp transformation and normalization in general, OPAP signed a memorandum of agreement with the following agencies for the implementation of respective programs. One, Department of Social Welfare and Development, Socio-Economic Program for Normalization in Bang Samoro. Two, signing of the Technical Education Skills and Development Authority, that is about technical education and skills development program for the Bang Samoro. Number three, Departments of Labor and Employment, Integrated Livelihood and Emergency Employment Program for Bang Samoro. And number four, Commission on Higher Education and the Bar Ministry of Basic Higher and Technical Education for the 10 agreements on higher education in Bang Samoro. On this point, I signed a memorandum of understanding with CHED and OPAP last October 30, 2019. Under the MOU, CHED, OPAP, and Education Ministry will coordinate with the relevant agencies to ensure the inclusion of underprivileged students,
children of the Commission emerged combatants and selected beneficiaries from the emerged six emerged camps in appropriate education programs. Meanwhile, we are waiting for the approval and implementation of quick response projects under the Mindanao Trust Fund Reconstruction and Development Project Phase 2 and the United Nations Development Program Support. As mentioned earlier, Barton and Amnesty shall help facilitate the healing process when combatants accused or convicted of crimes connected to the armed struggle will have a chance to have a healthy and productive life. I want to emphasize that amnesty and pardon are two different things. Amnesty is defined as a legal measure that ends all investigations and prosecutions against its beneficiaries. In contrast, a pardon removes or suspends a conviction after a sentence has been handed down by a court of law. In other words, a pardon can only be given if the recipient was convicted of the crime. Last November 2019, the Violent Vision Preventing Panel submitted a list of the violent members currently in custody and with pending cases to the GPS panel. Subsequently, OPAP through its office, of legal affairs, examined the document. After the OPAP coordinated the Department of Justice, the government sent us a formal letter is stating that concerned emigrant members can apply for the options made available by the Presidential Committee on Bail, Recognition, and Pardon or PCP-RTP. OPA, through the GPS Peace Implementing Panel, expressed willingness to facilitate the process of the DOA and the PCP-RTP. The government has also assured the environment that going through the PCB-RTP is just one modality and available to us. Our Congress can still avail of the amnesty once a presidential proclamation of amnesty is in effect. We already submitted a draft proclamation to the GPS panel, which was adopted. However, this process is overtaken by current events and authorities arrested some of our MILF members. For instance, one member of the MILF CCF support staff was arrested recently by government authorities. I hope this issue will be resolved soon, and I want to appeal to our partners in government to expedite the provision of amnesty. On transitional justice and reconciliation, let us now proceed to transitional justice and reconciliation, another critical component of the normalization process. Generally speaking, transitional justice aims to establish the truth, acknowledge victims' suffering, make perpetrators liable, provide reparation for past injustices, prevent future wrongs, and promote healing and reconciliation. Addressing historical grievances of irreparable people is integral to peace, justice, and nation building. The GPS Environment Peace Panels, therefore, commissioned a report to identify measures that would fit into a comprehensive of the GPS Environment Peace Panels last December 9, 2015, and applied 90 recommendations for the parties' consideration. We have had many consultations and workshops to discuss the way forward. Despite creating modalities to develop a transitional justice and reconciliation program, there has been little progress in this area. On the government side, President Rodrigo Roa Duterte signed Executive Order No. 79, dated April 24, 2019, creating the Intercabinet Cluster Mechanism on the Normalization, or ICCMN. One of the areas to be tackled by the body is on transitional justice and reconciliation. I understand that the ICCMN has developed a roadmap of DTR based on the report above by the Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission, and fortunately we have with us the chair of the DTR, Madam Mumbita. On April 29, 2019, The CPS and Environment Commission presented inquiries filed a joint statement summarizing the results of the special meeting conducted in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. In the same statement, the parties agreed to intensify efforts on normalization, including transitional justice and reconciliation. Subsequently, the panel chairs also signed the terms of reference of the GPH Environment Technical Working Group on Transitional Justice and Reconciliation on August 16, 2019 in Cotabato City. The environment has already identified three individuals who will be part of this TWT. However, the government has not yet named them. But I don't see a silver lining. The representatives of the GPS and environment representative attended a brainstorming session heard yesterday to identify possible next steps towards a joint roadmap on transitional justice and reconciliation. I want to thank the Swiss federal government for supporting this activity, especially Ambassador Karen Garcia and Madam Baker, who are with us this morning. Meanwhile, the Maximum Interim Parliament adopted BDA Resolution Number 56 on the resolution calling for the creation of the Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Commission in the Maximum Autonomous Region in Mindanao on January 24, 2020. As the name suggests, this body will be in no way a substitute to the creation of the National Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Board for the Bangsamoro and other government-led programs as recommended by the main DGR report. We approve this resolution and we hope that the formal structure with a clear mandate and effectively engage the national government for the acknowledgement of past grievances affecting the creation and institutional reform and ultimately for dignity and reconciliation. Finally, let us look at the Bangsamoro Normalization Trust Fund, or BNTA. After annex on normalization, the TPS and MIRF recognize the need to attract multi-dollar country support to the normalization to augment existing government resources. Indeed, undoing decades of inequality and poverty and creating an environment similar to a time before the start of the Anglo Peak will require an immense volume of resources. Hence, the parties resolve to create a trust fund wherein the budget for globalization will be released with efficiency, transparency, and accountability. On December 17, 2017, the GPS and MIRF pilot signed the guidelines for the operationalization of the Bangsamoro Globalization Trust Fund. The World Bank, as a fund manager, a fund administrator, presented to the joint implementing panel the design of the BNTA for August 16, 2019 in Cotabato City. The BNTA was then launched at the World Bank office in Makati on October 11, 2019, wherein Australia expressed definite interest in putting money into the BNTA. The European Union and Japan efforts expressed as well. It is experiencing delays. According to the GPS inspired, the Department of Finance was first endorsed a special presidential authority for SPA Maracanang before the creation of a multi-dollar trust fund. The SPA will be able to offer to sign a memorandum of understanding with the World Bank to correctly set up the trust fund and receive payments from donors. I understand the establishment of the trust fund is subject to two intricate policies. However, the BNTA in particular is critical not only to the normalization, but to the distribution of peace dividends and initiating sustainable development in conflict-affected communities. I hope by the time the Office of the President approves the SPA and the trust fund organized, our peace partners are still willing and able to provide support. This is our opinion. Before I end the presentation, I want to highlight how the peace processes test our ability to carry out necessary But I'm up to that purification for the political status, so I'll just start a healing and rehabilitation process in all conflict-affected communities. Within the 2 years of struggling, to achieve self-determination, the 3 years of finding a peaceful solution for the wants of our people, we have experienced both success and failure. We often say failure is not an option, but it is a prerequisite to success. Given the scope of normalization and the resources required to ensure its success, it seems an almost impossible task. Therefore, normalization requires political will, a proper utilization of allocated resources, both from government offers and from development partners, and access to relevant expertise and technical advice. Moreover, donor coordination and cooperation will be crucial this year, especially now that the normalization process is moving forward. As more peace building and development efforts are becoming visible on the ground, we will need to be more unified efforts, focused and objective and rigorous to avoid any redundancy or inconsistency. No doubt we find value in the system extended by international experts and consultants as part of our learning curve. However, I would like to emphasize that any program should not run our strategies and approaches. We will make the final decision or decide for our people. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you so much, Minister Mahir Iqbal. As of this moment, our speakers will entertain questions regarding the points they discussed. And with that, may I invite Ms. Malina Nathan.
Thank you very much. That was a very comprehensive presentation from both our speakers. And maybe before throwing it open to the floor for question and answers, I'm just wondering whether the speakers might like to comment. You said, Lee Luciano, would you like to make any comments on Chairman Bao's presentation? And vice versa.
Yeah, as you mentioned, the presentations are very comprehensive. Before we deliver our report, we shared both pilots and goals in order to coordinate or try to present both on the normalization and the contract. We covered a lot for the normalization based on what we have achieved last year and for this policy. We presented it in a way that all the deliverables were being presented and the political topics was equally presented by my co-chair, was also being presented in a way that their accomplishments were being shown. So that's it.
In general, our presentations are supplementary and complementary. Probably a little difference is that I am standing at the certain point and he is standing on another point. What is good there is that we both see the perspectives of both my colleagues.
Thank you very much to both presenters. The floor is now open for your questions. Kindly raise your hand and give a question, and the ground staff will be present with mics. And before you raise your question, please state your name and the organization or office from which you come from. All right. I see a hand right up there in the middle, and I think it's Dr. Unsi.
Thank you very much for organizing this event at the UN and at the Ban Mong Ban. I have two questions. that the presentation was cordially respecting both sides, the government and the MILF. But coming from the member of the parliament, coming from the youth and also from the academy and the CSO movement, what are the real roadmaps? Can you tell us what somehow offers us in achieving our goals come 2023, where there will be signed exit agreement? Second point is honest to goodness, reality check. Can we finish or pass the five important, at least five important goals within the time frame or within before October 2021, where I think that would be the filing certificate of the if there will be an election in the morning. So 2 points, what are the roadmaps and what are your honest assessments? Can we finish it, the normalization of the political track within the time period provided by law?
Thank you very much. Maybe I can start with Yusei Cristiano to answer both questions.
On the part of the TPHs, we firmly believe that there will be a signed exit agreement on 2022. On the normalization track, we have presented while ago the four phases for the normalization. Right now, we are on the later part of phase two, where the decommissioning of the combatants and their weapons are being conducted. And we are on time for the phase three. It will be conducted later this year. And for the rest of the combatants, will be accommodated on year 2021 to 2022 to include their weapons. On the delivery of the socio-economic packages, we are also doing our best to deliver what is needed to uplift the living condition of our combatants and their communities. Initially, we presented that we are giving a cash assistance of 100,000 in every decommissioned combatants, and we are also conducting a series of meetings with other agencies to deliver other socio-economic packages, like for example the jet for the study grant program, for the cash forward program, for the DOLE and the DSWD. We also have the JESTA for the technical and education skills development that was being signed by SIP. Wherein the JESTA sponsored a development scheme for all the combatants and their dependents who are capable of learning some additional skills. On the aspect of the housing that was being presented, we will be 500,000 for the 40,000 combatants, it will amount to around $40 billion for the whole program. That's why we made mention of finding some international donors if we can find donors, because we cannot really fund the budget right now. But on the transformation of our camps, we have already started the planning of the six major camps. We already have our planning session with the RPDO of the farm, and right now we are on the expulsion program for